Thank you for playing my music. I guess we'll keep the vibe going there. Yeah. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church. If you're a guest, we especially want to welcome you. There's some registration pads. We'd love for you to fill those pads out if you're a member or a guest. I'd like to have a record of your presence. There's also prayer cards there. There's information where you can indicate if you have questions about what it means to be a member of First Presbyterian Church. We're coming up on a new inquirers class. You can read about that in the bulletin or on the internet, note that. And also, I want you to know that next Sunday, our annual Labor Day gathering out at the lake the evening before Labor Day is a special time, and it's grown to be a visionary time where our pastor talks about our hopes and dreams and vision for the upcoming year. So you can sign up online and reserve a meal there. Or outside, I believe the deacons will be taking up money. You can bring your own meal, and that'd be okay. We wouldn't be offended at all. But come out and participate with us in next Sunday's Labor Day family picnic. We won't be here, so if you come here, we'll be there. But we will be here next Sunday morning as well. You'll be hearing more from John Franks. We'll have a farewell time for some important leaders and family members of our youth staff, and he'll be talking to you about that in just a second. Our catechism question plays into the theme of our evening service, and our evening service is the last of our miracle series, and we've been saying that miracles in the Bible are signposts that point us to a greater miracle, and that greater miracle Jesus himself points us to in the miracle of the resurrection. Our catechism question is number one. If you don't know any of the catechism questions, get this one down. At least you have one. It's better than none. It's real straightforward. What is man's primary purpose? I'll ask the question. Let's answer together. What is man's primary purpose? Man's primary purpose is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. Please stand to begin our worship. Now, we cannot enjoy God. We cannot glorify God because of death, because of sin. But Jesus came into the world to redeem that purpose that we just read about, and his resurrection secures it. In Acts 2, when Peter preaches that first resurrection sermon, he references Psalm 16. I'm going to read that tonight. Peter says, "This man was handed over to you by God's said purpose and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him," this is Psalm 16, "I saw the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will live in hope, because you will not abandon me to the grave, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence." Let's pray to him now with the hope of the resurrection to begin our worship. We praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that death could not hold Jesus in the grave. Sin and brokenness and evil that separated us from your glory and for fellowship with you has been redeemed. And your life and death and your resurrection places us with hope that our lives not only can become meaningful in this life, but for the life to come, we will be with you always. Lord, teach us about resurrection miracles and resurrection power and how to believe to the very end. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. I want to ask for Caleb Click and Clifton Tippins to stand right down here in front of the baptismal font. And then I want to ask for Chandler Macamel and Alyssa Preston and Mary Clayton Murphy and Francesca Fontanez and Cameron Anderson to all come and stand over on the other side of the Lord's Supper table. Our best recollections are that High Life and Upward Bound were started here at First Presbyterian Church in 1973. And much has changed in, 40-something years of youth ministry. The world has changed a whole lot. Youth ministry has changed a whole lot, but certain things have not changed here. In the midst of multiple transitions, a few things have remained constant. The first being that we as a church family believe that the primary responsibility for the discipleship of children belongs in the covenant family. We believe that parents, your role is God-given to be the chief and primary disciplers of your own students. But we don't believe you do it alone. Being covenantal means that the body of Christ takes vows at baptisms, and we say that we're going to assist Christian parents in the nurture of their children, and that includes the teen years, 6th through 12th grade. Another thing that has not changed is that we firmly believe and hold to the fact that the means of grace, the Word of God, the sacraments, and worship, and fellowship, and community, that those are the things, the primary means through which God transforms hearts. And so we as a youth ministry have been committed to that for 40-plus years as well. And then finally, I would say something that's not changed a bit is the fact that we still believe that our primary way that we reach youth is to model the incarnation of our Lord Jesus, who became man in order to pursue us relationally so that he might draw us to himself. And that is still the bedrock of what we do as a youth ministry. We don't depend on programming or gimmicks. We depend on pursuing and relationally connecting with students, particularly in discipleship. Now, all that to say, we come to a time now where we are sort of passing the mantle off from two men who have, and their wives, I don't want to forget Mallory and I don't want to forget Becky, who have laid down their lives for our youth. I can't talk too much because I'll get too emotional, but I want you to know how grateful I am for these men, their leadership, and the way they have given their lives to love our students. And I know you as a congregation want to join me in thanking them. Would you do that now? Thank Caleb and Clifton. And Caleb heads to Perimeter Church in Atlanta. Well, he'll be an assistant pastor there on the preaching team and working with young adults, so to speak. Did I get it close, Caleb? Is that right? And then Clifton moves to Jacksonville, his home. He thinks Jacksonville's his home, but we're praying precatory psalms that he'll realize it's not and come back to the promised land. But he moves to Jacksonville, where his family is, and he will be working part-time in youth ministry there and hopes to start a real estate career as well. So these two men, God has greatly used in our ministry. We're going to ask the elders, all teaching and ruling elders, in just a minute to come, and we're going to lay hands on them, and I've asked Elder Billy English to pray for these men because I want us to send them out. We always send out the best from our church to other places, which is why I guess I'm still here, right? But we're sending these out. I want you to send them out. And then we're also going to ask the elders, after we pray for these two, Elder Gary Boudreau is going to lead us in a prayer for this new team. This new team, a young staff, but a great staff that the Lord has given to us, and he provides for us in incredible ways, and we're going to pass the mantle, so to speak, to these. And so I'm going to ask you to join us as we pray for them and start another era of youth ministry here in our church. So elders, teaching elders, and ruling elders, would you come down? Let's lay our hands on these two men first. And Elder Bailey English, you can come and pray from here. And then we're going to ask Elder Gary Boudreau to pray. We're going to lay our hands on this crowd over here and pray for them next.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, our good shepherd, our Savior, our Lord, the Lord of the harvest, we thank you for these two laborers in which you have brought to us, Caleb and Clifton. Lord, we're so thankful for them. Thank you for their years of service here. And we do pray for them, and we offer great thanksgiving for their lives and for their commitment to Christ. And Father, our prayer for them is that they would every day fix their eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of their faith. We pray that, Holy Spirit, that you would give them daily a life of repentance. We pray that they would have a humble heart. We thank you for these and excited for them, Lord, for this new calling for Clifton as he goes to Jacksonville, not only a real estate career, but possibly a youth ministry there. And we pray that you would bless him in that endeavor. We pray for Becky as well and their children. We commit them to you and ask that, Lord, that they too would be a family of one in which they would also look to Christ. We pray for Caleb and Mallory and ask for them, Lord Jesus. Thank you for Caleb, this gifted pastor, this gifted preacher. Lord, I ask for him that for years that he would persevere as a pastor, that you would help him in the ups and downs of just in that life. And we pray for him as he transitioned to a ministry of young adults. Give both of these men, Lord, a heart to serve you. And we ask that they would be steadfast. And Lord, that you would deliver them from evil. And that you would guard their hearts. And they would ever look to the Lord Jesus for their strength and source and refuge. And we do commit them to you, Father. They would bear much fruit. They would do great good for the church and for the body of Christ. Again, Father, thank you. And through their lives, Lord, we pray that you would glorify your name. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good. Let's, as they're making their way, let's pray again, shall we? So, well, Jesus, we thank you that you are passing the mantle from these two to these five. We thank you specifically for Chandler and Francesca, for Mary Clayton, Alyssa, and Cameron. We thank you for their willingness to be involved with the youth of this church. And Father, I do pray for your power in their life. I pray that you would equip them specifically for what lies ahead. And I pray that you'd give them insight and wisdom into each of the children involved, that you would enable them to develop these relationships. And I pray that the Spirit himself would be in their midst as they work among our youth. But Father, besides what they will do, I pray for them as they are here with us and as they continue to grow in you. I pray that your very presence would become more real to them week by week, and they would therefore minister out of the abundance of their walk with you to our students. I pray, Father, that you would, as we just went over in the scripture, that you would make known to them the path of life, and they would discover, maybe for the first time or maybe afresh, that in your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. What a joy, Father, what a joy to walk with them as they walk with us. And so equip them and bless them in Jesus' name, amen.
And after the evening service, you'll want to greet Clifton and Becky, as well as Mallory and Caleb. We'll have a gathering here out on the plaza as we launch them out and say our goodbyes. I invite the ushers to come forward as we receive the evening offering. And I mentioned that tonight is the last in our summer series on miracles. Drew Epting will be preaching for us tonight, and he's been here a long time, but you may or may not know him. He came to faith in Christ as a baseball player at Augusta University and got involved not only with campus outreach, but with First Presbyterian Church. Later went on staff and has been on staff for 9 years and now leads our campus outreach Augusta region. He's also a seminary student who's taking classes at Erskine, but also Reformed Seminary. And so Drew and Jess have 3 children. He'll be preaching tonight about the miracle of the resurrection. Let's pray now. We do thank you, Lord, that your resurrection brings not only healing, but also hope. And we pray that you'd be near to those in our fellowship who need to be reminded desperately that there's healing and hope in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray tonight for the persecuted church around the world, our brothers and sisters in Christ who suffered because they identify openly with your Son, our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Be near to those brothers and sisters who maybe some are in jail, maybe some have been displaced from their homes, whether it's Sudan or other places around the world, China. We pray for you, Lord, to use even the persecution to stir your church and to remind them of the hope that we have in the gospel. And then near to our family, we thank you that you've placed us within a body. We thank you for our fellowship, in particular for the Forest Hills Parish. We pray for some of those members tonight. Thank you for Sally and David Roberts and their children, and Ricky and Charles Scarborough, who are preparing for the mission field themselves and their children, and for Pat and Randy Sims and Mark and Stuart. We also pray for Brenda Stonehouse and Julie and Chris Vickery, and for Ian, he's just gone off to college, and for Caroline as well. Lord, be near to these families and remind them of the resurrection hope that we have in the Lord Jesus. We do pray for next Sunday, the celebration of your Lord's Day, but also, Lord, the time together out at the Labor Day. We pray for safety. Pray that families would feel free to invite others and connect more deeply with people in our fellowship and in our community. We pray for Dr. Robertson as he will lead us in a visionary time of being reminded of our calling, that we live and we live together not for ourselves but for your glory and for the good of this community and for the sake of the gospel of the Lord Jesus. Use these gifts to that end, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Save to glory. Our Lord, rejoice. It's incredible singing and incredible music. I'm good to be with you tonight. I want to commend you and thank you for your partnership with Campus Outreach. I've really taken First Press for granted over the years, and as a young staff guy, and then becoming the director and interacting with other directors internationally and in our own country with Campus Outreach, and a lot of them would say it must be special to have First Press as a hub church. And I would just say, well, isn't every other church that we partner with like First Pres? And they would say, no, you have no idea. And not that those are bad churches, but that First Pres is a special church. And so I just want to thank you for your support and partnership with Campus Outreach, with myself and my family in particular, and ask you to continue to pray for our staff. They're in the thick of it right now, meeting freshmen, building relationships. We have 35 staff on 7 campuses in 3 states. And that is a ministry of this church to those campuses. And so just ask you to continue to pray for them. Tonight we have our last sermon in the miracle series, and I just want to make one comment about miracles. You know, we've been talking about how miracles are signs, but one other thing to think about is that miracles, this is something that's always been helpful to me, miracles are not just a suspension of the natural order, they're a restoration of it. And here's a quote that's been very empowering, very helpful. Miracles remind us of the way things are meant to be, and point us to the way things will be. They're not just a challenge to our minds, but a promise to our hearts that the world we all want is coming. They show us that in Jesus, the kingdom of God has broken into this world in practical, tangible ways. They should not just amaze, they should inspire us with hope. And none more so than the one we're looking at tonight, because it deals with something that every one of us will experience multiple times in a broken world, because it deals with suffering and pain and disappointment and loss, but it also gives us hope. So please turn with me to John 11. And in your pew Bible, that's page 1668, as we read about this climactic sign, miracle, in the Gospel of John and in our series. And I'm going to be reading from the English Standard Version. Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to him saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, this illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. I'll skip down to verse 17. Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha said to him, I know that he'll rise again in the resurrection on the last day. And Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary, saying in private, the teacher is here and is calling for you. And when she heard it, she rose quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. And when Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. And Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead 4 days." And Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me." And when he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The man who had died came out, his hands and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped in a cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Let's pray. Lord, you tell us that you look to the one who is humble, who is contrite in spirit, and who trembles at your word. And so, Lord, we want to humble ourselves before your word and recognize that it is the living word of the living God, able to transform us, able to comfort us, able to make us new. And we pray that you'd help us to see wonderful things in it. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. One of the hardest parts of my life, moments in my life, was when I was 9 years old and my parents got divorced. I still remember that we had just moved and my mom, we moved into this apartment, and my parents were staying in separate rooms, and I was only 9, so I didn't really understand what was going on, but I knew that something was wrong. And then about a year after that, I remember my mom calling us in and saying, "You know, kids, we're going to get your dad and I are going to get divorced." And we talked through that for a little bit. And you know, now looking back, I know the statistics. I know that 50% of marriages end in divorce, and unfortunately, in the church, that's no different. But at the time, you just have to know this: that I didn't know anybody else whose parents were divorced, as rare as that may be. And so for me, this wasn't just hard. It didn't just feel like something was wrong with my parents' marriage. It felt like something was wrong with our family, because I didn't know any other families personally who had experienced this. And so we eventually moved to a new house, I'm the oldest of three, and we stayed with my mom, and so we moved into a house with her. And I remember one day I was sitting on the couch, and I guess I had my baseball glove and a baseball. My mom could tell I was sad, and so she came up and asked what was going on, and I said, "You know, Mom, I just want to go throw the baseball," and that's what I used to do with Dad. And she said, "Well, let's go throw. And part of what, I was hesitant, part of what she was probably picking up on was that I was just sad. What she probably didn't know is underneath, I'm going, "Come on, you're a girl." That's kind of how I'm looking at it. It's one thing to throw with my dad, sorry, not to offend any women. There may be softball players in here. I was 9, give me a break. But part of what it was is, I'm used to throwing my dad. "You're not my dad." And so we went out into the backyard and we began to throw. Now, the way it started off was I just started, I catch the ball and I just lob it back to her. And so eventually she said, "Son, why don't you just go ahead and throw it?" And I said, "No, Mom, it's okay. My arm's a little sore." And so I just kind of throw it back. And so she said, "Drew, throw the ball." And I kept hesitating. And she said, "What's going on?" And I said, "You're a girl." And she was like, "Trust me, son, I can take it." And I said, "Okay, if you're going to challenge me, I'll do it." So she threw the ball, and I caught it, and I threw it as hard as my 9-year-old arm could throw it, and she caught it, it popped, and she threw it right back harder than I threw it at her. And I caught it and just looked at her with this utter surprised look on my face and said, "What was that?" And she said, "Bring it again." And so I threw it again, and she caught it, and she popped it back to my mitt again, and I was just utterly shocked. Now, here's the deal. Everything was okay for a moment. I knew my mom. But there's something I didn't know about her. My granddad played professional baseball, and she was the prize athlete of the family. And so what I came to find out later on was that my mom didn't just play softball. As she was growing up, she played baseball with the boys. And when she did play softball, and I don't know if they still do this, but they used to wear these short softball shorts. They didn't wear pants. And my granddad would always tell these stories about how when she would slide, she'd slide feet first, and have these strawberries on her hip as she'd come up with a grin ear to ear. I mean, that was my mom, and I didn't know that about her until that moment, but in that moment, everything was okay. Now, something similar is actually going on in this story with Jesus, because the people that knew Jesus knew a lot about him, right? Like, they knew he was a healer. They knew he was a miracle worker, right? He had healed the blind men and cripples. He'd helped them walk. He had multiplied the fish and the loaves. He multiplied food. And so they had this view of him, of this great teacher, this great healer, even a miracle worker. But what happens in this story is something that was so far off the radar, they didn't have a category for it. And what happened was, in the moment, you know, they come to him and they say, if you would just come over here and heal Lazarus, before, he's sick. If you'll come to him before he dies, he'll be better. But in the moment, their view of Jesus hit a ceiling. And then he proceeds to punch through it and say, your view isn't big enough. Now listen, we know the end of the story. We're on the other side of the cross. We're on the other side of the resurrection. And we just read the end of the story. But what you need to know about suffering, and some of you do know this, is that suffering has this tendency to produce tunnel vision, where it hyper-focuses you on what's in front of you, and it causes you to forget who he is, or at least to diminish your view of him. And so what this passage does for us is it actually helps us see three things about him that will really help us have an appropriate view of him in suffering. Number one, he's a Savior who waits. Two, he's a Savior who weeps. And thirdly, he's a Savior who wins. So first, he's a Savior who waits. Anytime we suffer, anytime we think about suffering, it raises the why questions. Why is this happening? Or how could a good God, why would a good and powerful God allow suffering to happen? But in this story, it goes from the abstract and the general down to the specific and the personal. It's not just asking, why does suffering happen? It's saying, God, why would you allow this to happen to me? So think about all the expressions of love and how personal this is for Jesus and this family. John highlights Mary as the special, or Mary as the one who anoints his feet out of devotion and love to him. When they come, they say, Jesus, he whom you love is sick, which gives us this really interesting insight into his personal life. You know, that he actually had friends. He loved the whole world generally, but there were specific people that he had this friendship with that was on a different level than others. Then it says, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister Lazarus. And then later on in the passage, as he's weeping, all the comforters say, look how he loved him. And that's what creates this interesting tension in the story, because when you read it, and I'll read it one more time, here's what it says. Verse 5, now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So, when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer. Now, I don't know if you're like me, but that's not what I expected it to say. What I expected it to say is, now Jesus loved them, so he ran to them. But what this says is, he loved them, therefore he lingered. That he didn't wait despite his love, he waited because of it. And that's a hard pill for us to swallow. Now think about it like this. When we were, 3 years ago, we were about to become new parents, and we were a couple months away from our oldest, Jane, who's now 3, and she was gonna be born. And so I was reading all these books to try to figure out how I could become the perfect dad, and one of the things really stood out to me was that it said, if you do nothing else, I'm a goal-oriented person, and this said, here's your number one goal. And I said, okay, I can do this. If you do nothing else, convince your child that you love them so early on that when you begin to discipline them, they won't question your love. You know, they'll feel the pain, they'll learn from it, but they won't question the motivation behind it. And I said, okay, there's a clear goal. I'm gonna try to do that. And so I would do everything I could with Jane, and I've done this with all three, to try to communicate how much I love them, how much they mean to me. And so I'd always tell them things. And even when they go to bed at night, I'd say, and I still do this today, I'd say, how much does your daddy love you? And if you were to ask them that, they would say, to the moon and back. I think it's from some children's book. And I just kind of picked up with it and was like, your daddy loves you to the moon and back. And so I'd say it every night. So then when we started getting to the point where we're disciplining Jane, I would sit her down and say, hey, listen, sweetie, you know that I love you, right? Yes, daddy, I know that you love you. How much do I love you? To the moon and back. I'm gonna discipline you. I'm about to inflict pain on you. I don't say that diplomatically correct, but I'm gonna inflict pain on you. But it's not because I don't love you. I do love you. I'm doing it because I love you. And she said, okay. And then I would inflict pain and we'd move on. Now, one night, she wanted candy before we were going to bed. And she said, Daddy, can I have some candy? And I said, no, it's bedtime, can't have candy. And you know how hyper you're going to get if you stay up all night, so start trying to, don't reason with a two-year-old, but that's what I was trying to do. And I said, and so I tried to pull my trump card out, and I said, Jane, listen, you know that I love you, right? And she said, no. I said, what do you mean we do this? We rehearse this every night. I've spent 2 years convincing you that I love you. You know that I love, no, Dad, you don't love me. Why not? If you loved me, you would give me candy. And I said, Jane, I will give you candy in the morning. You just have to wait, right? Doesn't that say something about our hearts? That, think about this for a second. She doesn't question my love when I inflict pain on her, but she questions it when I withhold candy from her. There's something about us that when we don't get what we want, when we want it, when we're asked to wait, we're so quick to question love. And so if that little story says something about our hearts, it also says something about God's heart, because he's a perfect father. And just as I have a better perspective than my two-year-old, God has a better perspective than me. And he has a good purpose, even if I don't understand it. Now, a friend of mine, maybe let's think about this on a small level and we can expand out. A friend of mine tells this little analogy about prayer. A lot of times he says we think about our prayer life as trying to get a Coke out of a Coke machine. And I wish it was really that simple, just put money in and get a Coke out. And he says, a lot of times that's the way we treat God. God, please give me this. I'm going to put my money in. I'm going to do what you asked me to do. Give me what I want. And then he says this, and think about it for a second. Do you ever get intimate with a Coke machine? Is there ever a time when you get intimate with a Coke machine? And the answer is absolutely, when it doesn't give you what you want. Because all of a sudden you start hitting it and shoving it. Next thing you know, you might be like trying to bear hug it and try to bring the whole machine down to get what you want out of it. And there's this sense to where sometimes God is so relational and so personal with us that he knows that what is best is that we need more of him, not just more of other things. And so he says, I'm going to withhold for a little bit because I want to be intimate with you. Now, I'm not saying that answers every question. But can't you understand that if he's a good father, then he could have a good reason to withhold something from you, to wait, to not go heal Lazarus right away? It at least says we might not have all the answers, but we don't have to question his love. That's what I love about the Bible, is that it gets my heart. That when I look at things in this passage, you know, it makes me, you know, I feel like his love doesn't seem to be real, but it's more real than I could ever imagine. Sometimes I feel like his word doesn't seem to be true because Jesus says, this will not end in death, and then right after that, Lazarus dies, and it's like, see, you lied. But we know the end of the story, that it's more true than we could have ever thought. That sometimes his plan seems crazy and doesn't seem to make sense. That's how I feel so often, and that's probably how they felt here. And that's why we need stories like this. To know that sometimes our Savior waits, but it's not because he doesn't love us. So we have a Savior who waits, but we also have one who weeps. Now, to get the force of his tears, we need to understand something from the passage. There's these two interactions with both sisters, so with Martha and with Mary. And what's interesting is they both come and ask the same question, or both come and say the same statement. Say, Lord, if you would have been here, he would not have died. But he gives them two completely different responses. And so Martha comes and says, if you would have been here, he would not have died. And Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. And Martha says, yeah, I know, I'm an Orthodox Jew. You know, that'd be equivalent to saying, I'm a covenant child. I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. And Jesus says, no, you didn't hear what I said. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the source of that power and of that hope. And it has broken into the present. That when you think about eternal life is not just something that begins after you die. You know, I work with college students, and a lot of times when I'm sharing the gospel, I'll just ask the question, what do you think eternal life is? What do you think that means? And they'll say, you live eternally. They just switch the words around. When do you think it begins? When you die and go to heaven. And so often, time after time, they're so surprised when they hear that Jesus actually says this. Now, this is eternal life, John 17:3, to know Christ. To have a relationship with him. It's not just something that starts after you die, it's something that begins now and lasts forever. But Jesus takes it a step beyond that, and he says it's not just something that's a present reality. It's also something that is physical in nature and not just spiritual. There are physical, tangible expressions of life that I am offering. So maybe think about it like this. Johnny Erickson Tada has this statement where she says, you know, suffering in this life, it's like the splash over from hell. And it reminds us that we live in a broken world. And what Jesus is saying to Martha is that in me, you experience the splash overs from heaven that begin now, but that one day you'll experience in its total fullness. Now, here's why this is so helpful and important. Some of y'all might be like this. My wife, I have her permission to share this. The first couple years we were married, we would get ready to go on a trip, anniversary trip, something like that. And I would always say, what are you excited about? Let's talk about what we're excited. And I would be saying, I can't wait to do this, and I can't wait to do this, and I can't wait to do this. And she would say, yeah, you know, I'm just excited to go and be with you. I mean, that was something to that effect was the way she would respond every single time. And so finally one day I said, sweetie, will you just tell me, why don't you ever get excited about where we're going and what we're going to be doing? And what she said, I'm sure some of you can resonate with. She said, Drew, just different things in my life has taught me, if I don't have any expectations, I'll never be disappointed. Some of y'all ever feel that way? If I don't raise my expectations, if I don't get my hopes up, then I can protect myself from pain. And she knows this, that's a defense mechanism, but it's real, it's deep in her heart. And part of what Jesus is saying to Martha, it is unbiblical not to have expectations. It's understandable to struggle with it. But you need bigger expectations for the kind of life that I can bring. So that's what he says to Martha. Then he goes over and talks to Mary, and Mary comes and says the same thing. Lord, if you would have been here, my brother would not have died. And then it just says Jesus weeps. He wept. So here's the question. Don't over sentimentalize this verse, or however you say it. We think of this as the shortest verse in the Bible. But I want you to think about what's going on in this context. What he just said to Martha is, I am the resurrection and life. What he's about to do is raise Lazarus from the dead. And yet in the moment, all he does is weep with Mary. You know, most of the time, I don't know what I'm going to do, but when we're in a hard time, Jess says, what's going to happen? I say, it's just all going to be okay. How do you know? I don't. But I still say it's all going to be okay. Jesus knows what's going to happen. He knows what he's going to do, and yet he weeps. Why? Well, let me give you a few things to think about. First, I think it's this. He validates her grief. See, in their culture, there was this philosophy called Stoicism that basically said if you will detach your heart, then you'll never experience pain. And it was a way to protect yourself from the suffering in this world. And we have a version of that that would be called Christian Stoicism. You know, as Presbyterians, here's something we can do sometimes. People begin to experience suffering. They begin to experience disappointment. And we say, you need a bigger view of God. Like, if you believed in God's sovereignty, you would know that he works all things for your good. And that is true. I'm not saying that's not true. But sometimes what we're doing is we're just kind of buying into our own version of Christian Stoicism that says we don't have to feel deeply because we know the end of the story. And Jesus cuts against that. He actually gives us permission to grieve. And what he says is, yes, you need a bigger view of me. But what you also need to know is that in my sovereignty, it doesn't mean I lack sympathy. That both are true in my heart. So he validates her grief, but he also identifies with her grief. There's this interesting, if you have a New American Standard Bible, if you look in the little margin, there's a note that said he was deeply moved in his spirit and he troubled himself. You know, the translation says, and he was troubled, but when it says he troubled himself, here's what it's getting at. He wasn't simply affected by what was happening. He intentionally entered into it. Now, I've been trying to grow in empathy as a leader. And so I was reading this article about how to grow in empathy, and one of the things it said was you should read fiction stories because long story short, it basically helps you learn to see things from these characters' perspective, and you can learn how to step in other people's shoes. And so I decided to go real big, and I started reading C.S. Lewis's Chronicles of Narnia again, which if you didn't know are children's books, because I wanted to challenge myself. No, they're really not just for children. But I did start the series over. I hadn't read them in 10 years, and so I read through The Magician's Nephew a couple weeks ago. There is this moment in the story where Diggory has found his way into the magical world of Narnia, right at its founding, its creation. And so he sees Narnia birthed. And then the lion, Aslan, comes up to him and he asks him to do something. And Diggory thinks for a moment that he could actually bargain with Aslan. See, Diggory's mother was sick, probably had cancer, but some kind of fatal illness. And so he thought for a second, maybe if I do what he asks of me, he'll do what I ask of him. Then he begins to abandon that thought. Well, here's how it picks up in the story. He said he thought of his mother and he thought of the great hopes he had and how they were all dying away. And a lump came in his throat and tears in his eyes, and he blurted out, "But please, please, won't you? Can't you give me something that will cure mother?" Up until then, he had been looking at the lion's great feet and the huge claws on them. Now, in his despair, he looked up at his face. What he saw surprised him as much as anything in his whole life. For the tawny face that was bent down near his own, and wonders of wonders, great shining tears stood in the lion's eyes. They were such big, bright tears compared with Diggory's own that for a moment he felt as if the lion must really be sorrier about his mother than he was himself. Now, Christianity is the only religion in the world that says that God is not just aware of our pain. He's not just aware of our grief. He's not just aware of our suffering. He's affected by it. That he enters into it. That he's actually experienced it. I had a staff couple a little over a year ago. Had a miscarriage pretty late into the pregnancy. They had to have a D&C. And I remember meeting with them about a month after it had happened. We talked on the phone a lot, prayed together, but I was in Milledgeville spending some time with them, and I just said, "How are y'all doing?" And really, to my surprise, they were doing really well. They were probably doing better than a lot of other people around them who were very close to them. And I just said, "How are y'all holding it together so well?" And I'll never forget the response of the wife. She said, "God knows what it's like to lose a child." And that's meant the world to us. Now, I want you to think about what she says for a second, because it's very similar to Diggory. She didn't say, "God's gonna raise my child." He didn't. The child died, right? It didn't say, "God's fixing everything." What she said is, he identifies with my pain. And that was enough for her in that moment. Now, what we go on to find out about Diggory is, Aslan's gonna heal the mom. But in the moment, it was enough to know that the lion identified with his grief. So he validates it, he identifies with it, and then he redeems it. Because he gives us permission to grieve, but he doesn't say grieve without hope. Because what's going on is in Jesus' turmoil of emotions, these aren't just tears of sorrow, they're tears of anger. And that leads us into the last point. We not only have a Savior who waits and who weeps, we have a Savior who wins. Two times in the passage, there's these words, deeply moved. Jesus was deeply moved in his spirit. And what was interesting is every single commentary I read talks about this. That is a word in Greek that is used to talk about how animals snort in rage. Eugene Peterson in his translation of The Message says, when Jesus saw her sobbing and the Jews with her sobbing, a deep anger welled up within him. He's trying to draw that out. And maybe one of the most helpful things for me in understanding what's really going on here is this. One of the ways this word could be used was as a horse snorting as it prepared to charge into battle. And so what's going on is that Jesus is not just overwhelmed with sorrow. He's not overwhelmed by Lazarus's death. He's about to overcome it. And so he charges in like a horse ready to face battle and defeat his enemy. Here's how B.B. Warfield puts it in his little essay, The Emotional Life of Our Lord. The spectacle of the distress of Mary and her companions enraged Jesus because it brought poignantly home to his consciousness the evil of death and its unnaturalness. It's violent tyranny. In Mary's grief, he sees and feels the misery of the whole human race and burns with rage against the oppressor of men. It is death that is the object of his wrath. And behind death, him who has the power of death and whom he had come into this world to destroy. Tears of sympathy may fill his eyes, but that is incidental. His soul is held by rage. And as he advances to the tomb, in Calvin's words, as a champion who prepares for conflict, what John does for us in this particular statement is to uncover the heart of Jesus as he wins for us our salvation, not in cold unconcern, but in flaming wrath against the foe. So he's angry because as he's looking at what's happening to Lazarus and he's thinking about all of the death that's going to happen, that has happened, that will continue to happen, he charges forth. He says, this is not the way it was meant to be. I'm going to go conquer it. And he doesn't go calmly. He goes aggressively. He cries out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. And Lazarus walks out of the grave. Now, let's just double click on it for a second. He overcomes death, I think, in at least two ways. The first is this, and this will be really quick. He undermines it. Meaning he uses death to serve his purposes. Isn't that part of what's going on in the story? Is that where they were feeling all this sorrow, they wanted him to come heal Lazarus, and he didn't do it, and now he's died. Well, when he raises Lazarus from the dead, what do you think that did to their faith? How do you think that increased their view of him? He actually used suffering to serve his own purposes. And he does that in our life, just like Joseph, just like other people in the Bible that we've seen, where they experience incredible suffering. And then at the very end of his life, Joseph says, what you intended for evil, God intended for good. Romans 8:28. I do think we got to be careful not to just throw that on people too quickly, but it's still true that he works all things for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. And then later on in the passage, he actually says, because of that, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. What does it mean to be more than a conqueror? John Piper says it like this. To be a conqueror just means to simply defeat your enemy. To be more than a conqueror means to make your enemy your slave so that it now serves your purposes. And in God's sovereignty, that's what he does. He actually undermines the things that were intended to hurt us. But the second is that he undoes it. Obviously, Lazarus is brought back to life. But just think about it for a second. Lazarus did not come out like a zombie, right? Like he didn't come out like a dead man walking. When they unwrapped him, it was as if he had never died in the first place. There was not a sign of decay. And that's really important because John actually says two times in the passage that he had been dead 4 days, which in their culture, decomposition starts to set in after 3 days. And so we can know for sure that somebody is dead once it's been 3 days. And Lazarus doesn't show any sign of decay. He looks as if he was a new man. And you know the story in Lord of the Rings, at the very end, famous part, where Sam sees Gandalf and he says, Gandalf, I thought you had died. I thought I had died. Is everything sad going to come untrue? And what this says is, yes, absolutely. And I don't know to what extent that's going to happen, but I at least know this, that broken bodies will be made new. Whether it was an accidental thing where a finger is cut off, or whether it's something that happened in war, or it's just the ravages of cancer or disease, that broken bodies will be made new, that hearts, that wounded hearts that are scarred over with thick tissue that make it hard to feel things anymore will be healed. That personalities who aren't the same anymore because of incredible sorrow and tragedy in your life, that one day they'll be better. It's going to be undone. Friday night, we were having a family movie night. And we'd put Eli, he's our youngest, we put him down. And Jess and I had Jane and Evelyn. And we were watching her favorite Disney movie, Beauty and the Beast. And at the very end, just kind of hit me with fresh force, that once the beast dies, you know the end of the story, the end of the movie. Once the beast dies, Belle falls on him and says, I love you. And all of a sudden, He's taken up and something begins to happen. And what you find out is that because of her love, the curse was broken. But it wasn't just broken, it was reversed. You remember that? That all of a sudden the beast actually turned back into the prince that he used to be. Lumiere, the candlestick, and Clocksworth, the clock, and the armoire and everything else turns back into human beings, and the castle goes from being this dark, gothic-looking place to this beautiful castle, and outside it was no longer gloomy, but it was sunny and it was bright, and everything was made new. Now, here's what's interesting. It doesn't say that they forgot what happened, and that's probably going to be true. But it doesn't just mean the curse was broken and we just kind of moved on. It literally shows an incredible drama. The curse is reversed. It's undone. And I don't know everything that that means, but even just the thought of that inspires us with hope. Isn't that incredible? Tim Keller says this about miracles. We started earlier saying this. I just want to finish the quote. Miracles are not just meant to challenge our minds. They are a promise to our hearts that the world we all want is coming. They show us that in Jesus, the kingdom of God is broken into this world in practical, tangible ways. They should not just amaze us. They should inspire us with hope. It's incredible. But the question is how? How does that happen? How does Jesus win our salvation? Not just for Lazarus, but for all of us. And the answer is in verse 53, because it goes on to say this, that after this happened, from that day on, they made plans to put him to death. So here's what Jesus knew, that in order for Lazarus to come out of the grave, he'd have to go into it. That he would have to take his place. That in order to win Lazarus's life, in order to win my life and your life, he would have to give his out of love. And to the degree that you experience that in your heart, when you see him going into the grave for you, to that degree, you are inspired with hope. So that you can say, when you look at the cross, I don't have to question God's love. That I might not have all the answers, but one thing that I do have answered is that God loves me, and he has a good purpose for me, and that he is able to use suffering to overcome suffering somehow. And that when you look at the cross, you can see a God who weeps. Not just one who's aware of what's going on in your life, but one who has intimately experienced suffering, our suffering, and even more suffering than we've ever experienced. And then you can be filled with hope because you know that he didn't just stay on a cross. That the rest of the story is that he rose from the grave, proving that he had paid sin's penalty in full, and now because he raised, one day we will raise, and that that power, that future resurrection power, has now broken into our current reality and is loose in the world. It fills our hearts with hopes. So what do? Believe on him. That's the whole point of John. It's the whole point of the miracles. Believe on him, and not in the way that you believe in a fact, but in the way that you believe in the pew that you're sitting on. That you trust it, that you put your weight on it, that you rely on it, that you rest in it. And as you do, you'll be able to sing, "There's a hope that burns within my heart. It gives me strength for every passing day. A glimpse of glory now revealed in meager part, yet drives all doubt away. There's a hope that lifts my weary head, a consolation strong against despair, that when the world has plunged me in its deepest pit, I find the Savior there. Through present sufferings, future's fear, he whispers courage in my ear. For I am safe in everlasting arms, and they will lead me home." Let's pray. Lord Jesus, you are the resurrection and the life. You are the source of hope and of healing and comfort and life. And in you we can experience the splashovers of heaven now, even in the midst of our brokenness, even in the midst of our pain, as we long for the day when everything will be made new. Please save and convert anyone here who doesn't know you, Lord. And please strengthen and comfort those of us who do so that we may live with hope and joy for your glory. And so that we can say, just like the song does, And until that day comes, we will go and warn the darkness that the light of Jesus Christ has overcome. In your name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing. Revive us again.
Benediction. Now may the God of peace, who raised Christ Jesus from the dead, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything you need to do His will, that you might believe in the healing power of the resurrection as you wait on Him, as He weeps with you, and as we celebrate that day when He will win. Go out in peace and hope. Amen.